one person a week and rotate it. Cool. And stuff.
Can you
get it? Like, she likes to literally be like, she just wants to come in.
Okay.
Only person that ever wants to come in. So we're gonna dive into actually IP peering next Monday's plans.
Interesting.
Okay.
We had our plans this morning.
Okay. Great. So the purpose of this time is to just like get increasingly clear on what we want out of that lesson.
Yep.
And we're gonna follow the same general flow of the meeting with desired outcomes from earlier this week.
Okay.
So the purpose of this time is just pressure testing the clarity of your vision for key points, key questions, misconceptions for that lesson. And here's the protocol, okay? So first, we're going to start with this. Talk to me. What is the purpose of the Monday lesson on context? You have it up, right?
Yep, we just got we just discussed our long feedback, so
okay.
I'm going to be stumbling a little bit, I'm sorry. But the purpose is to get them to be better at writing context than on notes.
And how great, so needed, how does that connect to the larger unit goals for this process piece?
So larger unit goals, evidence selection, and they need to be writing strong analyses because this unit is focused on historical analytical writing.
Yep, I heard, and I think like this is the unit where kids are reading and writing about historical figures, and we're really introducing context for the first time.
Yep.
This is the first lesson on context, right?
Essentially, yeah. So it's pretty sucky. I'm going to like practice that right now because I don't know why I had this misconception that they have had context before. Ronika told me they have not.
Brand spanking new.
Exactly. So the next step is in my editing of this plan, Ronika showed me Silva's lesson plan from last year where it was like a context boot camp. So she said we need to start to do now with just like a paragraph with the bolded lines as context so they can try to make sense of what is the purpose of context. So, yeah, I'm going to revamp this whole plan.
Let's talk through for a second some of the thinking that went into that little shift, okay?
Great.
The do now that's set up right now is a kind of guided discourse model. Can you, do you have the Silva plan?
No, I can get it, though. Did you have a specific question about the plan?
My question is, like, how are we debriefing it?
The do now?
Yeah.
Oh, like the marginal size? Yeah. It's like a summary. Yeah, I think but I don't know if I have, like, a sentence.
Thank you for being so flexible.
Thank you for
get it.
Okay.
One call came with the correct answer. What do you call a sentence in a paragraph? Yeah. This is the evidence.
Great. Can you scroll down to see like
the
what they're writing about?
What is the purpose of the bold sentences in a paragraph?
What is the difference between what Silva's... take a second to just read through the comment bubble, and then we're going to look at this, and we're going to think through what we want to take. Because I think there's elements of your plan that are quite strong.
Do you have any questions? Or is
the plan? So, what's really strong about this plan is the very specific scripting that I need to incorporate into mine. Also, showing an exemplar body paragraph so they can understand the context in relation to the evidence, assertion, everything.
So I think that the tweak here is that rather than make it comparative and guided discourse.
Because they don't know it. They don't know what it's in for.
They need a similar guided discourse model, but on a single paragraph. Okay.
Yep.
So can you scroll down and look at the lesson as a whole? What comes after this?
They get a lot of at-bats, but with texts that are not based in the civil rights, that are like silly or like just completely different, so they understand it better.
Yeah.
So they're reading short passages and then they're writing their own context.
I think we can tweak this so that students do it about Jackie Robinson.
So you do want it to be all...
I do, but we're going to work on that in a second.
Cool.
Before we go into anything else, I want us to just get super clear on our key points of what they want to take away and what the introductory scripting is going to look like.
Okay.
So first, I want you to just on the bottom of this page script, like literally what are the key points about context that students must know by the end of the lesson?
These are different from the network. Is that okay?
What do you have?
So I have the two from the network that I kept are short and significant. Short because context should be like 1 to 2 sentences. Significant because without it, we don't know where the quote is coming from and we're not ready to keep reading.
Mm-hmm.
What I added was relevant to assertion and evidence, and something Jama told me she's doing in history is the 5 W's,
mm-hmm,
with the focus on time.
Great, so you're giving me criteria for success, which I think is good, which is like, what should our context look like?
Oh, CFS,
I want you to zoom out.
No,
zoom out. Don't apologize. This is a good start. So I want you to keep this. Now I want you to zoom out one level further. What do students need to know and understand about context at the end of the lesson? Think purpose, think like location and paragraph. Think all of those things. Drop them down and maybe some complete sentences.
Gotcha.
What do you have?
So I have three. The first one is that context is important background information. The second is that it comes before evidence in a body paragraph. The third is that it comes before thesis in the intro paragraph.
Great, I'm going to flip a couple of things.
Gotcha.
First, and pressure test on clarity. It says, context is important background information. Background information on what?
The topic?
Some of it, and then I think additionally, it gives important background information on the evidence that's about to be provided.
Cool. So this would be like the fill-in-the-blank kind of notes for them? Like
potentially.
Okay.
Let's get there in a second. Next, before evidence in body paragraph. Great. Like, why?
To clarify for the reader, perhaps the need of that piece of evidence?
Mm-hmm.
Or the purpose of that piece?
I think that's right. To clarify any unclear, like, pronouns, people, names that are provided in the direct quotation.
Pronouns in a
quotation. So, like, in a piece of evidence might be like, he stood up and gave a speech, like, who's he? Say more here. So then, the last piece is, you said after the, or prior to the thesis in the introduction paragraph,
like the frames?
Yeah. We want to use those two pieces of language separately.
Okay.
So you can draw a connection with them when we do intro lessons later. But in the intro, we're just going to call that frame.
Okay.
And they'll use that language
cool.
throughout class period.
Gotcha.
Cool. So based on this, what are the highest level conceptual questions that we're going to ask during this lesson that are going to leave kids understanding these two key points around context. Take a second and write those down. One or two questions that are going to drive those understandings.
So I have, why do we need context, and what does context do for the reader?
The first question is strong because it's basically a purpose question. Mm-hmm. So it's really similar to Silva's question in her form of what's the purpose context?
Uh-huh.
So strong. What would you want students to say to that?
To help ground the reader in the evidence that's to come, or to put us in the time period of this document, or
to give background information.
Mm-hmm.
The second one, what does context do for the reader?
Mm-hmm. I was trying to get at this, the grammatical thing.
Mm-hmm. I think there's, I would ask two alternative questions. Mm-hmm. First, like, what makes context strong? So, like, soliciting these key points that you came up with, and additionally asking, like, the question after looking at stimuli, how do we craft context? Or, like, what is important to provide context on?
What?
Yeah, what do we...
Important to provide context?
Yeah. Great.
What makes strong context?
Yeah. Where in the lesson do you think we're gonna like to ask those questions?
So why do we need it? I think it would be at the end of that.
Mm-hmm.
What makes strong context would be when they're independently writing.
Yep.
And what is important to provide context on in the beginning, right?
Yep.
Like, this is a CFS.
All of those. I think, like, my purpose of asking that question is, I think we ask those questions all the time. Like, initially when we look at the stimuli, then during guided practice, and then during mid-workshops, again and again and again and again and again as we show call work. Great. We're now going to pivot to, like, literally real-time revise your entered in the material, like, which is the do now, from what you have, which is the example, non-example of context, into this general format. So I want you to take the next 4 minutes, and I'm in your email right now. I'm sending you the Muhammad Ali exemplar. And what I want you to do is just recraft the questioning so that it mirrors like what you just crafted, that driving at those key points, okay?
Lines. So we're getting a, it provides background information, correct?
Yeah. Write out what you want kids to say.
Exemplary.
Yep.
Exemplary. So are these BPQs, or are these, they go on the document for the doing?
Good. I want you to script, I want you to script, like, what students, and you can do this directly in your lesson packet mm-hmm. for next week. The purpose is, like, what are students responding to as if it's the do now broad launch question, and then what are the questions that you're going to ask to unpack? Okay. Does that help?
Yeah.
Walker. So I have the paragraph copy. Mm-hmm. I hold in the context, which are, I believe, three sentences. Mm-hmm. Nice enough, short enough. So the first one I wrote was, what is the purpose of these bolded lines? Exemplar would be to provide background information. What makes these sentences helpful? It provides key details, who, what, where, when, why. And then if these sentences were not in the paragraph, what impact would that have on the reader? The reader would be confused about the quote and his name change.
I think you're off to a good start here. Okay. I, in particular, like the first question, which is just like running that conceptually and the purpose of the lines.
Mm-hmm.
Two things. One, in the paragraphs that I sent you, like, I don't think I really set you up for a ton of success here. I believe that the second body paragraph is slightly more clear for kids in going from conceptual to concrete around that purpose than the paragraph.
Yeah.
Reason being, look at it. There's a full and complete quote, which is where our kids are in writing development on the evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And if we look at that context, it's Muhammad Ali spoke at Howard University Historically Black College in 1967 to an African American audience.
Yeah.
That's just so concrete around the purpose of context. So I think I would just, like, my first piece of feedback is tweak it.
Use
when
that
you're picking,
for the dinner.
Right, so transferably, what we just landed on is a strong planning move, is when picking a stimuli to go off of, especially when it's a new skill, pick something that's super concrete. Okay, that's my first kind of, like, transferable piece here. Second, I'd like to see back pocket questions. I'm going to just, like, jump in and, like, model as if, and then I'm going to narrate what would be in the plan by narrating my engagement move. So I would put this as the do now, and that everybody writes question would be, what's the purpose of the bolded lines? What makes these sentences impactful? Okay? Great. So then I'd have everyone write, pencils would be down, and then I would say, track me, scholars today, we're learning a brand new skill that's going to help move our essays from good to great. This skill is one that you already use in history, and I'm going to teach you how to use it in a literature